Pastor Tom Fields because I felt that way a couple weeks ago. One thing about being sick, it makes you really appreciate good health when you get it back, right? I want to share with you a little bit this morning about something we've been talking about in our home fellowship group recently. We've been talking about prayer. And we came across a verse that we've all read a lot of times. In fact, you read it for the New Testament reading this morning in your bulletin. It's a little verse that says, always keep on praying. And I thought, well, that's a nice verse. God said it, so it must be good. I looked it up in a couple other translations. The Old King James said, pray without ceasing. That might be familiar. Other translations say, never stop praying. Pray continually. And then from the Living Bible, always keep on praying. And stop to think, why would God say that? I mean, you know it's important. The same God that said, do not kill, do not steal, said, always keep on praying. But why would he say that? Now, sometimes when we pray, God answers right away, and that's always nice. Like, oh God, I've lost my keys. Where are they? Where's my keys? They're in your other coat pocket right where you left them. Oh, right. But sometimes when we pray, we don't get an answer right away, and the temptation is to just go on to something else, but the Bible says, always keep on praying. So, as we look at that, first, we want to remember a few things that we know about God. The Bible says that God is a good Father. And if you have take your outline from your bulletin there, and you follow along. And there's a few things we know about God because he is a good Father. And number one, God is a caring Father. The Bible says, cast all your care on him, for he cares for you. And Isaiah said, can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she's born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you. And then the Apostle Paul said, I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor the present, nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. You can probably think about a time when you realized that God cared for you personally. I remember at Ohio State, I'd go to class during the day, work in the evening, and I'd come home to study as long as I could stay awake. And one night I felt really bad about things. I forget what I tried to do that day at school, but there was, at the time, like 50,000 students at Ohio State. And I felt, I'm just a number. Nobody there even knows my name. I'm just one of 50,000 students. And so I left my studies on the table and went over by the bed, picked up the Bible and started reading. And first thing I read was in Isaiah chapter 43. And God says, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. And all of a sudden I realized that it didn't matter if anybody else in the whole world knew my name, God did. And that's what really mattered. And you can probably think of a time when you realized that God cared for you personally. We know that he loves the whole world, John 3:16, but he loves you and he cares for you. Another thing we know about God, he's a consistent Father. Have you ever known someone that was inconsistent? You never knew what kind of mood they'd be in. When I worked at AT&T, there were a couple co-workers that I knew beyond any shadow of a doubt, not to engage them in any worthwhile conversation before they'd have their morning coffee. I mean, they could be, you have a pleasant conversation with them later, but if you talk to them before they have their coffee, better be ready for some verbal abuse. It was not a good thing. And some people, you probably know people that are like that. They'll say one thing one day and something totally different another day. But the Bible makes it clear that God is not like that. He's not moody. He doesn't say one thing in the Old Testament and something else totally different in the New Testament. In Malachi, he said, I am the Lord, I do not change. Jesus, the Bible says Jesus is the same, you know the scripture, yesterday, today, and forever, right? Psalm 59:10 says, God is changeless in his love for me. Even when we're too weak to have any faith left, sometimes you feel that way. Even when we're too weak to have any faith left, God remains faithful to us and will help us. For he cannot disown us who are part of himself. And he will always carry out his promises to us. And in Romans 11:29, God will never go back on his promise. He's a consistent Father. You can always depend on him to say the same thing, to feel the same way. Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. God is caring. He's consistent. And Psalm 34:18 tells us that God is close. He's a close Father. Think of a time that you felt close to God. I can remember some times during worship when they'd be closing the meeting. I couldn't believe an hour and a half or 2 hours had gone by already. Time just seemed to stand still. Other times during prayer, when you just know and feel the closeness of God. Perhaps you've gone through an experience and you knew God was going through that with you. You could feel and know that he was close to you. Listen to what he says in Hebrews. I will not in any way fail you, nor give you up, nor leave you without support. I will not in any degree leave you helpless, nor forsake you or let you down, or relax my hold on you. In Psalm 27, though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. God is never too busy. He's close. Listen to what it says in Psalm 34. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and save those who are crushed in spirit. He knows how you feel. God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in times of trouble. God's caring. He's consistent. He's close. And look at number 4. God is a competent Father. Now, children sometimes think their dad can do anything. I know as a child, there was nothing my dad couldn't do. He could fix anything that was wrong with the car. He did everything that needed to be done around the house. He did the plumbing, the electrical work, the carpentry. I mean, he could do everything. And later, when some of us kids had to correct or change some of the things that he'd done, we realized he wasn't really that competent after all. We wondered how some of the things actually worked as long as it did. But we felt he was pretty competent. Well, children may feel that way about their dad, but we can feel that way about God because he is competent. He can do anything. He can fix anything. In fact, the Bible says nothing is impossible for God. When the Apostle Paul was trying to explain about how great God was and what he could do, someone pictured it this way. He started off writing Ephesians 3:20 by saying, God can do anything you ask. And he looked at it and no, there's more than that. So he added a little bit to us that God can do anything you can ask or imagine. And he looked at it, no, it's more than that. Then he added another, God can do above all you can ask or imagine. And he looked at it, there's more. God can do abundantly above all you can ask or imagine. And he looked at it again. Then added one more word. God can do exceedingly, abundantly, above all you can ask or think. Amazing. Just think about it. Words upon words to explain what God can do. In 1 Corinthians, it says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has even imagined the things that God has prepared for those who love him. So, as we think about God being a good Father, caring, consistent, close, competent, all these things, we can come to him. John 5:14 says, how bold and free we are then to become in his presence, freely asking according to his will, sure that he's listening, and if we're confident that he's listening, we know that what we've asked for is as good as ours. So we can have confidence to come to God. The Bible tells us to ask. And why would he say, after you've asked, to keep on asking, to keep on praying? Well, now, sometimes we know we ask for the wrong things. And I'm not going to deal with that. I mean, James says, when you ask, you don't receive, because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasure. So we know there's sometimes we ask for the wrong things. God says no. Sometimes we ask with the wrong motive, with the wrong mindset. God says no. But what about when we ask for good things, when we ask for the right things, and we pray and we don't get an answer right away? And God says we need to keep on praying. I'm going to suggest a few things, a few reasons that the Bible gives us why we should do that. And you may think of some others, that's fine. But here's a few things the Bible says, a few reasons the Bible says why we should keep on praying. Number one, if you're following along in your outline there, number one, it keeps our focus on God. I like the way the Message translates Psalm 25:15. It says, if I keep my eyes on God, I won't trip over my own feet. I like that. I got big feet. Easy to trip over. But if we keep our focus on God, if we keep on praying and our focus is on Him, then we're not going to be sidetracked by something else, especially ourselves. Psalm 105:4 says, look to the Lord and His strength. Seek His face always. That's a good picture there. So seeking the face of God. And the Message, using it in different, another view of it, says, keep your eyes open for God. Watch for His works. Be alert for signs of His presence. If you keep on praying and your focus is on God, then you're not going to be sidetracked by a lot of other things. And you're going to know when He answers. Number two, another reason to keep on praying, it allows God to work on us. Not always as easy as the first one, but a lot of truth there. Listen to what the Bible says. God says, I'll refine them as silver is refined. Test them for purity like gold is tested. Then they'll pray to me by name and I'll answer them personally. Sometimes our prayer isn't answered right away, because we need to grow up. We need to become more mature in Christ. A good father, for example, wouldn't give the keys to the family car to a 7-year-old who asked him, right? There needs to be some growing up that takes place before he asks for the keys and expects to get them. But sometimes God wants to change the situation. Sometimes He wants to change us. I remember hearing the story about the guy who was complaining to God about being so weak and unhealthy and just feeling so poorly. And God took him out to the backyard and showed him this huge rock out there. He said, 3 times a day, I want you to push this rock, push on this rock. And so the guy faithfully did that for several weeks. And one day he looked at it and said, this is accomplishing nothing. The rock hasn't moved 1 centimeter. And so he was complaining, talking to God. And he said, God, I've been doing what you said for 3 weeks and nothing has happened. The rock hasn't moved a bit. God said, I didn't tell you to move the rock. I told you to push on the rock. Go look in the mirror. And we looked in the mirror. He saw someone who was a lot healthier, a lot stronger. And he looked totally different. Because God wasn't working on the situation. God was working on him. And sometimes that's true when we don't get an answer right away. God's working on us. Sometimes He's changing the situation. Sometimes He needs to change us. Sometimes He may need to change someone else. Picture someone praying for a spouse. And as God looks, He sees that the spouse needs, the person that He has in mind needs to grow up a little bit and make some changes in their life before they're ready to, for the marriage that he wants to have, bring forth. And so sometimes you may be waiting for someone else that needs to change in the situation. But all those examples, when we read, one of the reasons we need to keep on praying is it allows God to work on us, on the situation, and on anyone else involved that may be part of that prayer. And then number three, why should we keep on praying when we don't get the answer right away? Number three, it keeps God's priorities in view. You know the verse in Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Sometimes we see things from God's perspective instead of our own. Our view might be short-sighted. We might only see part of the situation, part of the problem. But God's view, in God's, you know, God's kingdom, he sees the whole thing. Abraham Lincoln once said this. He said, when I look down on the earth, I can easily see why someone could be an atheist. But when I look up to heaven, I can't see how anyone can say there's no God. It all depends on the perspective. Another reason that we need to keep on praying when the answer doesn't come right away, the Bible tells us in Romans 6:13, for example, and in a couple other places as well, that continuing to pray oftentimes will reveal our heart. It'll show what our real motives are. It'll show what we're really thinking. The Bible says, when the rulers of Babylon sent emissaries to find out about the sign from God that had taken place, God left the king on his own to see what he would do because he wanted to test his heart. Sometimes God may be testing our heart. Because when we pray and we don't get an answer right away, and we keep on praying, that can reveal what our heart really is. Famous preacher of last century, Harry Arnside, preached all across the country in different crusades. In the middle of one crusade, he was handed a note from someone in the audience, and there was a famous atheist there who traveled around the country also lecturing on atheism, and he challenged Ironside to a debate. And Ironside said, right there in the middle of the service, stop, and he said, okay. He said, I accept this challenge to debate, and there's only one condition. I'll bring to the debate 100 people who have been, had their lives completely changed and transformed by the presence of God in their life. And you bring with you 100 people who have been similarly had their lives helped and changed and transformed by the doctrine of atheism that you teach. And so you can imagine the excitement that went around. And the day of the debate came, and there was a huge crowd in the auditorium, and Dr. Ironside marched in with his 100 witnesses with him. The atheist never showed up. So he used that time just as an opportunity to preach the gospel and present the gospel. The real value of the situation was the heart. What can change the heart? What does the heart really reveal? And when we continue to pray, when we don't get an answer right away, it reveals the condition of our heart. Not that God needs to know it. He already does. How many of you have been asked a question by God and you know it's not because he needs to know the answer. It's because you do. A lot of times, several times when God talks to me, it's from a question. And it's usually a question that God already knows the answer to, that I need to know the answer. And sometimes just hearing God ask you a question, as you formulate the answer in your mind, you know what the answer is. Another reason why God tells us to keep on praying, even when the answer doesn't come right away, number five, it establishes our trust. It shows what you're really trusting in. Are you trusting the circumstance, the situation? Are you trusting what other people say? Or are you trusting what God said? in Psalm 34:7, there's a, I like the way the Message translation goes. The usual, the old King James says that angels are encamped around us when we pray. And that gives you one picture. But listen to the picture that this puts it this way. God's angel sets up a circle of protection around us while we pray. So while we're continuing to pray, like the Bible says, to keep on praying, while we're doing that, an angel of God is setting up a circle of protection around us that we may not be aware of, but as we continue to pray, that circle of protection is still effective. Galatians 6:9 says, do not allow ourselves to get fatigued by doing good. At the right time, we'll harvest a good crop if we don't give up or quit. So we need to keep on praying. In Habakkuk, there's an interesting challenge there too. It says, talks about waiting for the answer that hasn't come yet. It says, this message is a witness pointing to what's coming. It aches for the coming. It can hardly wait, and it doesn't lie. Even if the answer seems slow in coming, wait. It's on the way. It will come right on time. A lot of times when the answer doesn't come right away after we pray, it's not a question of needing to change us or the circumstances or someone else. All those are valid. But sometimes it's a matter of God's timing. I remember reading about a missionary that woke up one morning and just really wanted some oranges, some fresh oranges. Unfortunately, right there where they were ministering, there was a drought in force. There wasn't fresh fruit around. And so she didn't think anything more about it. But then later in the day, when her husband went to town to get the mail, there was a package there, and it was a package of oranges. And at first, she realized it was a miracle, of course. But then she thought about what a great miracle it was. Because in order for the oranges to arrive there that day, God had to have put it on somebody's heart weeks ago to make arrangements to send the oranges to the mission field. So it gives you a whole additional perspective of God being outside of time that restricts us. He can do something weeks ago so that something happens exactly the time that you pray for it, that orchestrates the events of the situation. In fact, there's a verse in Isaiah 65:24 that explains a lot of things that we don't even realize at the time. Isaiah 65:24, God says, before they call, I will answer, and while they're yet speaking, I will hear. Sometimes God can hear a prayer and have already set into motion things that are taking place so that that prayer can be answered. A matter of trusting God's timing. One of my favorite quotes about timing is from my wife Patty. She says, God's rarely early, he's never too late, and sometimes he resets the clock. You can probably think of examples of those. But it's important when you pray right away, and God says, always keep on praying, his timing might be involved. And his timing is always perfect. It's always worth it to wait on God's timing. Like Habakkuk says, wait for it. It's coming at just the right time. Before I pray, I want to share some prayer requests. And while you're thinking of any others, there are some